7, and I realized I could probably get this done and go ahead and put it up there with the chapter 6. Anyway, so on with chapter 7. Now, on chapter 7, my guy, Buyaid, he was channeling. We were having weekly sessions. People were, you know, really liking him. He was coming out with some great truths from the Brotherhood and why people were here to awaken our consciousness and things like that. And he just told them all kinds of really great things. They really liked him because when he came through me, he was just really down to earth and pretty much told it like it was. He said things like, you know, that karma, he didn't believe in karmic debt, so to speak. He just believed that, you know, everything was there for a purpose, and we work toward evenness in things, you know, so that if you felt like something wasn't right, you just worked till you got it right. And you always wanted to apply the golden rule in anything you did because you wanted to keep creating more evenness in your journey. And you wanted to make sure that you had, you know, love in what you did. One of the things he said, and this is what I wanted to read here, he said, when your standards are high, do you lower them like your adversary does? Or do you keep your standards high? Make them as you, entity. Bring them up to you. When they start seeing you in your light because of their own growth, they will love you more. Then another foe is relinquished from your path. But he kept them pretty much spellbound in a lot of stuff, and told him basically that, you know, you didn't want to create anger, you wanted to create peace. So one woman in the audience, she said something in regards to that, and about, you know, having, she didn't have very much patience and stuff like that. He said, I say to you this, all is easy to do when a desire is there, but I do not tell you to suppress your emotions, just be in control of them. Even, he said, Jesus showed anger in the temple. If shouting brings you peace, then by all means shout. But remember this, the one you shout at may wish to shout as well. Then you have two shouting entities and no one will be heard. So that was the kind of stuff that he relayed to people. During that period of time, he would, after the channeling sessions, as far as teaching them and all, he would have talks with the students, and they would ask him questions like, how old am I? And have we been together before? And stuff like that. And one of the things that I thought was pretty cute that I was reading, he said that he had seen a relationship with one of my male students, our male students. And it's easier to tell a woman that she was a man in a past lifetime than it is to tell a man that he was a woman. But anyway, he told a male student that his spirit guide and Buyaid had a grand battle over him in a past lifetime. And he said, of course, you were a woman in that lifetime, and your guide won the battle. And he just chuckled. And the student said, what happened? Because he was making a face about being a woman. And Buyaid said, he knocked me on my ass, entity, and I had the respect to stay down. So everybody got a big chuckle over that one. But he just had a really good rapport with people. In this chapter, I had a horrible dream about my husband at the time and my father, and something like he was remarried and my father had died or something like that. And the way I had explained to me that was my way of relinquishing them. It was just one of those really powerful dreams that it just hangs over you for weeks because of the feelings from it. But anyway, in this chapter, we were talking about him still doing a walk-in, getting permission, because I wanted him to be very impeccable with who he chose. It had to be a man that did not drink. It had to be a man who was single. It had to be a man that we were not taking away from any journey whatsoever. So I was, you know, being very careful about what we wanted between us. And he would go and find something and come back and say, no, he drinks, or no, he's not healthy, his body's, you know, weak, and things like that. So it was becoming more understandable that this wasn't going to be as easy as we thought it was. But I realized that, you know, there was a possibility that I could have a better journey, even though I had to give him up as a teacher. But at the same time, like I said, I was still in that main thought of he was going to come in and take over the body, take over the mind, instantly change out, and then he could still be this grand teacher for everybody. But he would be doing it himself and not me. One of the sessions that we had with our class, one of our students asked Bui Aid what a judgment was. And this was something else I wanted to read to you, what I had written down. He said, "Child, a judgment is an emotion that holds you back from evolving. There are two sides to this truth. I will explain. First, you have the negative side, the part of you that criticizes, and then to the extreme of this, condemning. The other side to that is the side that honors, or to the extreme of this, to glorify. You use a word that is truly judged by many." Now I'm not going to say the word because I know my grandkids might listen to this. So he said, "This word that you say in anger," and it's the F word, okay? "So, stunned, quiet, an enlightened master using a curse word?" But he continued onward, making his point. "There is a truth in this universe that words are no thing entities. Emotions are the truth of every moment. In another country, this word may mean eat. Different emotions then, you see. Words may be judged differently by different people." He continued, "It is when you feel the emotions of those words within your own soul, see what it is being created within you, and feeling yourself going to extremes due to it, that you must allow the thought to your own mind for the love of who you are. How do I relinquish this judgment? When you truly desire this relinquishment, it will be allowed. So be it." And they all said, "So be it." And they asked, "Are guides a judgment?" And he laughed. He said, "Some are, and they should be relinquished if they are holding you back. As I told this woman, me, I channel through, when or if I become an emotional block to her soul, I should be relinquished as well. Guides are just a tool, child, to help you grow, no more, no less. There will be many along your journey, spirit as well as physical. It is time to move on when you have gotten what you were meant to learn. But in relationships, we hang on until the last moment, and in doing so, sometimes create hurt. If you could only know what the lessons are first, accomplish them, and then move on to the next teacher, life would be less complicated. Sometimes we choose the hard road to make the lesson stronger. Then at times, it takes us many journeys to learn the lessons. That is why we have come back from the Brotherhood to share our knowledge, to help you grow, and bring you into the total knowledge of who we are to one another. We choose not to send one entity, but many. We do not wish to make the same mistake again and allow another brother to be crucified. Indeed?" And they all said, "Indeed." So anyway, because of this thing about relinquishing your guide and me thinking about this dream, I told him, I said, you know, reflecting back on this, I'm beginning to think that I wasn't relinquishing them. I'm thinking they're relinquishing me. Anyway, he was still looking for a body, and it was just taking a little bit longer than, you know, I thought it would, because I'm just a picky person, what can I say? So anyway, happy holidays, everybody. I hope whatever holiday you're celebrating is happy and merry, and bless all of you. Bye-bye.